There are a lot of people today that look back at the year 2000 problem, better known as Y2K, and think, that was fake. Y2K? That never happened. People were just freaking out about something that was not real. There was a lot of fear-mongering, that planes would fall out of the sky, mortgages would roll over, and you'd have 100 years left to pay. The world would explode, all financial systems would collapse, and the world was going to end. And look, like with everything where people with absolutely no technical background are talking about something, see both the TikTok hearings and the Facebook hearings, there's a lot of people that have no idea what they're talking about and are just gonna make things up that sound somewhat convincing, but speak to any software engineer of the time, especially going back to the 70s and 80s, and this was not a nothing happened situation. This was an incredibly serious problem. And the reason why nothing happened is people spent many, many years and many, many hours ensuring that systems were updated to not be handling time using 2 digits. The problem was first publicly discussed back in 1958, and by the 70s, tens of millions of dollars were being spent on resolving the problems. But that same level of fervor doesn't seem to exist around the 2038 problem. I did a video on this back in 2022, and since then, certainly some progress has been made. But this is not a solved problem. This is not a problem that is solved by just making every package a 64-bit package, by using 64-bit CPUs, by using a 64-bit distro. This is not that simple. Actual work needs to be done, and this problem is not going to be resolved by just sitting around and just pretending like it doesn't exist for another couple of years, and then it just magically disappears. This is only going to be resolved by actually talking about the problems, actually making people aware that this is an issue that needs to be dealt with. Now, for anybody unaware, the 2038 problem is based around a concept known as Unix time. This is the number of seconds that have passed since midnight, January 1st, 1970. This is the way that time is handled on a Unix system. However, this is also embedded into things like the C standard library, so it is also relevant under Windows as well. The iOS system, they have an epoch of a slightly different time, however, it also does handle Unix timestamps, and various other systems make use of Unix time in different ways, but just know it is a very common way to handle time in computing. Now, the earliest date that can be represented in Unix time is the 13th of December, 1901. Keep in mind, it is signed, so it supports both positive and negative numbers. The full range is on screen right now. But the earliest date doesn't really matter. We're not going backwards in time, we're going forwards. The highest date that can be represented is the 19th of January, 2038, specifically at 3:14 a.m. and 7 seconds, at which point a signed 32-bit integer will overflow, and how it is handled is entirely dependent on the system, on the language, and everything else around it. It could crash the software, it could segfault upon launching, it could fail to build, it could segfault when using some specific function of the application, or the value could just roll back all the way to the start and completely break your timekeeping. Now, you may reasonably say, well, just don't use a 32-bit OS and don't use 32-bit software, and then it's just not a real problem. And that's a simple way to look at it, but it's not that simple. A lot of software is programmed, sometimes that being legacy software, sometimes just weird software with 32-bit requirements, where it just has that innately built in, and people kind of just forgot about it. This is especially true when dealing with embedded devices that run outdated software, because it may be addressed in the latest version of a package. But if you have an embedded system that's running a version that's 5 or 10 years out of date, nothing's going to address that. And there are people that do care about this problem, but they are few and far between, and one of those is Bernhard M. Weidman, an OpenSUSE developer who every so often makes a post like this. Today is Y2K38, the 2038 problem commemoration day, T13. We are 13 years away from this becoming reality. This is a follow-up to a post made 2 years ago, which was then followed up by another post 2 years ago, which was then followed up by a post 1 year ago, where if you look at the list of things that have a problem here, sometimes it grows, sometimes it shrinks because, you know, new problems are being discovered, old problems being addressed, but things are getting better. Problems are being pointed out and problems are being fixed. But this is the most important part. These aren't theoretical. Oh, if I look at the code in this way, it probably won't work after 2038. These are problems that are demonstrably real on a system set after the start of the 2038 problem. It's a computer. Maybe trying to access the internet is going to become a bit of a problem because of, you know, making sure certificates are updated and all that stuff. But when we're talking about building software, you can just change your system date. And if you change your system date to a point after that point and problems start to happen, well, that's an issue, because if problems are happening when you set it yourself like that, those aren't problems that just magically started existing because you changed the date. Those are problems that exist because there are 2038 problems. Again, minus the certs issue, because those should be broken because you're setting it to a date after the certs expire. That's not part of the problem. That's a different thing. That's how certs should work. So this right here is a list of problems that should still exist today. I don't know why some of them still exist on the list, because some of these actually have been merged already, but separate issue. The ones that haven't been merged are problems that still exist today, but it is not an exhaustive list. There are almost certainly tons of other problems that nobody's even tested yet. Nobody's tried to build and run the software after 2038. Nobody even knows the software is going to break. So before I say anything else, if you're a developer, test your software after 2038. Even if it's not your main testing, test it after 2038, because there might be a problem in there that you have no idea about. It might not even be a problem with your code. It might be a problem with a library you rely on. So let's talk about some of these problems. One of these is so very important, the most important, something you could never possibly live with if it ever happens: breaking your uptime after 2038. How are you gonna brag on the internet if your uptime doesn't work correctly? Or how about an actual serious problem where your source control management does not work anymore? Not Git, but Mercurial breaks in 2038. So this has been reported for quite a while now, back in 2023, and is something to consider for the next format iteration. So I guess that next format iteration is still kind of a while away. Now, another potentially big one is GCC14 failing to compile in 2038. This is not as bad as it initially sounds because of this option being included, -M32. This is for building code in a 32-bit environment. One of the devs responded in 2024, "Yes, we aren't using 64-bit TimeT on 32-bit and won't for a long time, if ever, considering that x86 might be done for good in 2038. That is x86-32, not x86-64. People still call them both x86. Technically, you shouldn't, but yeah, this means the 32-bit variant. Now, I like that goal. However, considering how many 8386s and 8386 clones are still out there in production use cases, I have my doubts. Django GraphQL JWT has its test fail in 2038. We love that. Another one with test failing as well, Python standard num. Now the thing with this library is it might actually be a problem in the test suite itself, where they are making some specific requirements around the date. So if that doesn't line up correctly, then it just breaks. So it's not necessarily a problem with the library, but having your test suite break is still a problem. And I have no doubt some of you are gonna have fun with this one. Systemd fails to build in 2038. Now, before you get your hopes up and say, oh my god, after 2038, no more systemd. So this is actually doing its job correctly. They have an assertion that basically is checking if anything else is going to break after the 2038 problem, and they just handled it a little bit too aggressively, and it also broke systemd generally. So it's actually doing its job correctly here, just a little bit too much. Now, Python itself has had plenty of its own 2038 problems, and here is one that existed in 3.12, with tests failing after 2038. Again, they have some assertions that check that things aren't past 2038 for various other things that could be a problem, and it broke Python. Also, there are problems in this library right here, Python exiv2. So as I mentioned earlier, the underlying issue is the maximum value of a signed 32-bit integer. I think some distributions already started to compile their 32-bit code with d time bits equals 64, d file offset bits equals 64, but that is only part of the solution. Code that handles timestamps regularly is added or rewritten, and every time developers need to remember to not use int there nor long on 32-bit systems, but long or int64t or just time t. I myself sent PRs in the past using atoll for timestamps. We should not do that anymore. Same for this here. Maybe we could add some code linter that will notice occurrences of this right here. But there will likely be other problematic things that it will not find. I open the discussion with GCC devs about this. See you next year, because the problem will still not be addressed by then. We'll make some steps, but there'll still be a lot of work to do. Basically, what he's suggesting is if you're handling time in a 32-bit way, in a dangerous way, you shouldn't be doing so anymore. You should be throwing warnings. GCC should be throwing warnings to tell you, hey, don't go and do that. That's bad. Stop writing code like that. Now, no solution like this is going to be perfect. People ignore warnings. They use C libraries at a higher level from languages like Rust and things like that, where the warnings may not be shown. So until any solution is actually in place, please tell developers, and if you're a developer yourself, please go and do so. Build and test your code after January 19th, 2038. Deal with the problem today. Don't put it off until years into the future, because maybe it's not a problem that is going to be on the desktop. But if someone uses your library in some embedded device, that's going to be in there for 5 or 10 years. And even if you fix it, you're going to have no way to get that update to them. But what do you think? Do you think this is a big deal? Do you think in like 2037, there's going to be all these news articles talking about how the world is going to explode because of the 2038 problem? I really hope there is, because that's going to be great content. But if you're a developer, have you thought about this problem in your code base? If you're a developer of a desktop application or a library, do you think about the problem in different ways? I would love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out my Patreon, Scribes, LiberoPay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and I'm probably going to stream. If I'm still doing YouTube stuff, I'll just stream into the 2038 problem, just because it'll be funny. We'll be right back. What is-